Hello and good day. I hope you are doing well today. In this video, I am going to discuss about valve casting or understanding valve casting from the perspective of foundry. There are a lot of foundries who are doing casting for valve, but they do not understand that what is the requirement from the valve perspective. So in this presentation, it will give a brief detail about what are the things that we have to look for when we are developing valve castings. This is specially made for foundry people. So let us start this video. First, the index. We will see what are the terms, common terms in valves. What are important standards in the valves which we have to follow. What are the typical NDT in the valve castings. And what are the other testing in valve castings. So, these are the four major topics that we are going to cover in this presentation. So let us see terms in the valve. First is the size, obviously the size. Size can be in two form, either in inch or mm. It can start from say half inch and it can go up to 60 or 80 or whatever size it is. But normally the valve size are coming from half inch to 24 inch. Then the number of size will reduce. So that is one. Also in mm it will start from 15 mm, so 15 mm to 24, that is 600 mm, and it will be in a multiple, like it will start from 15, then 20, then 25, then from 40, then 50, then 80, 100, 150. An inch it will be till 2 inch, it will be like half inch, 3/4, 1 inch, 1.5 inch, 2 inch, and then it will be 3 inch, 4 inch, 6 inch, 8 inch, all the even numbers will be there up to 24, and it can go higher also, 16, 7 or 80 inch also. So that is size. If you get a very odd size, it could be from an API 6A valve, like 2 1 by 16 inch, that could be an API valve. So this will give you an indication that which particular standard they might be following, whether it is for upstream or downstream. So it gives you a rough idea. If you get a very odd sizes like 4.5 or say 21 inch, probably you will never get a 21 inch valve. So that is what you have to look for when you are looking at size. Second, rating of the valve. Now here when we say rating of the valve, means what is the pressure carrying capacity of the valve, which indirectly implies that what should be the thickness of the valve. Okay, these numbers are in two forms, that is, one is ASME and other is DIN standard, which is a German standard. In ASME it will be 150, 300, 600, 900, 1500, 2500 and 4500. There could be intermediate rating also, but very rarely you will see those. Okay, and in German standard there will be PN2, it will start from 2, I mean PN2 it's 2 bar, then PN6, PN10, PN20, 25, 40, 50 and so on, 63, like that it will go PN100, there will be many ratings like that. PN100 means 100 bar pressure will be there as a design pressure. So that we have to see. I mean, For a foundry, it is not an important terminology as such, as compared to size, I will say. But rating gives you an indication of how complex a casting can be in terms of thicknesses. You know, when we talk about 1500 rating, it means the thickness is much higher because the pressure will be very, very high. So you have to understand that when we talk about 1500 or 2500 rating, the thickness will be more, there will be more complication, and especially for flanges, I mean the valve with end connection flange, you will have a lot of problem. And if you want to do level 2 or level 1 castings, it will be tough task for you to follow. So that is the significance of rating. So you must know that. Third, material. A lot of materials. But mainly in the valve industry, there are few material which are more used. There will be an odd case, but I will say 60% of the cases WCB is used. For remaining say 40%, out of 40%, 30% will be stainless steel, and remaining 10% will be mixture of almost say 15 to 20 materials. Let me show you the material list. As I said, carbon steel will be more, 50 to 60%, alloy steel will be 10%, even low temperature carbon LCB, LCC will be say 10%, stainless steel will be 20-30%, remaining duplex or nickel base or like inconel, monel, hastelloy B, hastelloy C, that will be very very less, maybe 5% or 10%. Here what we have to see, the critical part for the material is that when we talk about carbon steel, it means the carbon content is 0.3% max, okay, and when we talk about stainless steel, then that is 0.08% carbon. Here in stainless steel, the percentage of chrome, nickel and moly will be higher. We have to follow ASTM standards to know what are the chemical composition for each. The points which we have to remember is carbon percentage, carbon for stainless steel, so carbon steel material is 0.3, for stainless steel it is 0.08, duplex also it is 0.08, nickel is more in duplex, then CE value, that is carbon equivalent value, that is 0.43%, as it is given, there is a formula for that, and we just have to apply that formula and get the value for carbon equivalent. Aluminium percentage, this is one another important point which we have to follow. You know, for degassing, a lot of foundries are using aluminium. So the aluminium shots are there, and they are putting that shot when they are doing the, just before the pouring. This is for degassing. So whatever gases has been generated during the melting, they are trying to remove it by putting aluminium. But however, the problem of aluminium is that if it is higher than 0.008%, we will have problem with the microstructure. So then again we have to check whether the microstructure is in line with our requirement or not. So it, this aluminium, we have to see many times the valve manufacturer will say that the aluminium has to be less or equal to 0.008%, even though the casting is very simple, for example carbon steel and or stainless steel, and you don't have any problem, like you are able to meet all the chemical requirements and other things, but this could be a point where you will have a problem. Third number which we have to consider is PREN number, that is pitting resistance equivalent number, especially for duplex material. So there are tests for that, and there are formulas also. So based on that, you have to calculate what will be the pitting number, especially for duplex steel, while manufacturer are asking. Okay, so this is little bit about material. Anything about this will be very 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 less, I will say less than 2%. So if you focus on this many material grade, probably you will cover 90% of the valve industry. Let me go back. So material is third. Fourth is end connection. Here end connection can be different, flange. There also in flanges there are different types, like raised face and RTJ and RT groove. There is a groove end connection also. So there are few raised face flange connection. There are others like socket weld, there is butt weld. When you have a valve with socket weld or butt weld, it's probably the easiest valve to cast, because when we talk about flanges, we have a thickness, a particular thickness of the flange that comes in the picture. It is actually much higher as compared to the valve body thickness. Now this is the problem when two different thicknesses are there and the valve thickness is much higher. So when we are trying for solidification, the valve internals will be solidifying first and then the flange. But the problem is that we are flowing the metal from the flange area. Okay, in that scenario, we will have a problem for solidification and major defects will be on the flange itself. Many times it happens that in the flange areas, you will see porosity or you will see gas or there is solidification, and then there are microporosity you will see. So all these problems, mostly because differences of thicknesses. So a lot of people in the foundry also, what they are giving as a solution is that they will increase the thickness in that area. So they will put a small rib or a boss, just to make sure that the solidification is in such a manner that the liquid is flowing from the flange area to the middle of the valve, you know, the based on the methoding which is done. So end connection, when you have flange, be very careful, see, study the drawing properly, and then you can commit to the valve manufacturer whether it will be level 2 or level 3. If it is a butt weld or if it is a socket valve, you can simply go ahead and you can take that casting, you can make that casting very simple. You can go for level 2 also if required. Level 1 very rarely for nuclear it is required, but in other cases you don't require level 1. Level 2 is okay. Level 2 at the sampling level and level 3 can be at the production level. Okay, this level which I am referring is from ASME B16.34. They have given different what are the level acceptable levels for RT, which indirectly says what is the level of defects that are allowed acceptable in the valve castings. Okay, next we will see important standards in valves. First is pressure rating, which is ASME B16.34. Here they will give you this standard, a particular standard will give you the combination of pressure, temperature, material, and what will be the rating of the valve. These four combinations you will get. But if you don't, if you, only two things you need, mandatory you need at least three of them actually. One is the material, what material we are considering, what is the temperature. Okay, and then out of the other one, like the pressure or the rating, if you have one, you can calculate the other one. So this is important, because if you don't know when you are doing your evaluation and then when you are doing quotation, if you don't know the pressure, understanding of pressure rating, what will be the thickness, and you are just taking the casting for development and then you understand, oh, the thickness is much higher, or we are having a lot of problem now and we are not able to develop, then it will be a major problem. So you always see then what is the pressure rating. Higher the pressure rating, more the thickness, more problem can occur, especially for flange valve. So you make sure that you see thoroughly that what is the casting and what is the pressure rating. That is one part. Also, I mean, if the valve casting is with more thickness, then there will be RT to be required. So RT will take more time. So there will be cost implication, delivery time, there will be more. So all these things we have to consider when we are making quotation for development of casting. Second, thickness. Again, this is coming from ASTM B16.34. So for base on inside diameter, they are giving the thickness. So different rating, different inside diameter, you will have different values of thicknesses. You can simply select that. Now here what I wanted to emphasize is that many times it happens that the designer is giving, the valve designer will give us say 12 mm is from the standard, so they are giving 12 plus 1. When the foundry people, when they start to development, what they will consider, they will say 12 plus 1, so let us start with 13.5 or 14, and they will start with that. So even if they reduce, they are somewhere close to around 13 or 12.5 or something. They will not try to understand that, you know, 12 is the limit. Okay, so you can go up to 12 also. Okay, and from there you have to see. So many times it happens that thickness, we have to understand that obviously we cannot go lower than 12 and no one will accept that requirement, even though in many cases it can suffice the requirement actually, but no one wants to take the chance. And when they say minimum thickness of the valve is 12, we have to go for 12. Try to be as close to 12 as possible. Okay, I know there are a lot of considerations and a lot of problems when we are doing valve castings, we are making those castings and there are problems are there, but try to see that how close you can be 12. The more closer to the minimum valve thickness, the more benefit you can get actually, because you will get more orders from the customers, because your castings are lighter as compared to other, and thickness is everywhere. So 12.5 and 12, that is a difference that you will get an order and you will not get an order. So make sure that you are as close as possible to the required thickness. When you see the tolerances on the valve thickness, Speak to the customers. Try to understand that why they have given plus 1 or plus 2 or plus 3. Sometimes they are giving plus 2, plus 3 also, because they have seen that there are a lot of variation due to casting process. So try to see and try to speak to them and see what we can do, how you can reduce the thickness and come as close as required to the required thickness from the standard. Face to face and end to end dimensions. When I say face to face and end to end dimensions, I mean as per B16.10, face to face means when there are two flanges. So we are saying face to face dimension, and when there is a butt weld or this, then we are saying end to end dimension. So these dimensions are given from the standards. Now a lot of time it happens that, you know, when we are doing the casting and then there is a problem like face to face, we are not able to match, or we are giving higher values of face to face and thickness is lower, and back to back, back face to back face, flange distance is getting problem. So all those issues are there. So what you have to do is follow the standards and see what are the values that are there, what are the tolerances are there, and try to see as much as possible that you follow those things. You can do two things. Try to make sure that first you maintain the face to face, and second is maintain the thickness of the flange. Whatever the remaining distance is there, that is back flange to back flange distance, that can be much lower. So for example, if you have the face to face as 200 mm and your thickness is 20 mm. So your remaining distance of 160, you can have 155 or 156 also. So that will not be a problem. But if you try to go the other way around, then you will have a problem either with face to face or either you will have a problem with thickness. So try to make sure that you understand what is face to face distance, end to end distance, and the implication of this to the back to back flange distance. That is very important. Next, flange detail. As per ASME B16.5, here you can see that as per this diagram, you can see that different tolerances are given for different parameters A, D, B, and P. So this we have to follow. If you are within this, you don't have to go to the customer to ask for any deviation. Can we take this deviation or can we take the deviation? Try to see that you follow this. And when you are doing your methoding and when you are preparing the die or when you are preparing the mold pattern, try to see you are following all these dimensions. No doubt in sand casting it won't be possible to have holes as as-cast feature, but for investment casting you can have as-cast holes with following this dimension. So if you are not confident that you will not be able to maintain these tolerances, do not go for as-cast holes or such. You go for blind holes and then you drill it and follow these tolerances. Next, top flange mounting details. Lot of times, especially for tuning, say ball valve, this is important because ISO, you have to follow ISO 52211, the standard, for to know what should be the flange thickness, what should be the drilling options, and what should be the PCD for that, what should be the hole dia and number of holes. All that information is available in ISO 52211. So these standards you must refer, and pressure testing. Now this is optional. Very few people are doing hydro testing of the casting also, and then they are supplying it to the customer. So you have to follow API 598 standard. They have given the what are the pressures to be followed for testing for both hydro test and shell test and seed test. Seed test won't be there for you, but shell test will be there. So that we have to follow as per API 598. And pressure testing times for what should be the timing for each test, that also is given based on rating as well as size of the valve. So these are few important standards from the valve. You should have a copy of this with the foundry people. So whenever you have a problem or anything, before just running to the customer for asking for deviations and for explanation or other things, you can first go and refer all the standards and try to see whether you are able to understand and are you able to meet the standards. If you are not able to meet the standards, then the next level is that you go to the customer, to the valve designer, and then you speak that these are the problems that we are facing. because of so and so limitations or problems or our inexperience in dealing with such kind of castings. So these are important standards. Next, typical NDT in valve castings. Radiography. Again, radiography, complete procedure, complete evaluation is there, is not as per B16.34, but there is a separate standard for this actually. That is section 5 is there, which gives the complete detail about radiography. But for valve people, we have to go as per B16.34. Here, what we have to do is first try to see that what are the defects levels that are required. That is first for different thicknesses, and what is the source that is required based on the thickness. There are two sources actually. Iridium is one for up to say 50 mm, and for higher than that there will be a cobalt 60. So you have to see that which source we are. If it is cobalt, then your again time, delivery time will increase, cost is much higher. So all that thing we have to consider when we are seeing this radiography. So you know, when you are, when you know that rating of the valve is higher, don't just commit time of say we'll give you the casting in three weeks, or you need at least 1 or 2 weeks for cobalt testing also. So that thing we have to consider. So you must have a copy of B16.34, so there also you will see the radiography details. MPI and LPT actually, that is magnetic particle test and liquid penetrant test. Both details are given as per B16.34. There are different annexures, annex 2 and 3, I think. There they have given all the detail, and let me show you the acceptance criteria. This is as per standard. So there could be a linear indication and round indication. Different thicknesses, what are the acceptable defects they have given. So we have to follow this. If it is within this range, it is acceptable and it can go for the next level. Visual inspection as per MSS SP55. It's a standard, very simple. They have given lot of different photographs and this, and we just have to compare and see whether it is able to meet that visual inspection levels or not. PMI, that is positive material identification, mostly 100% compulsory for stainless steel and those components, especially when you have an order for 316 and 304. So in that case you need a PMI machine. Many customers are asking that we have to do it in front of the TPI or in front of the customer. What the PMI will do, it will identify nickel, chrome and moly, these three elements, and it will give you the percentage values. So if there is duplex, so you know, okay, nickel should be between 24 and 27. So okay, that is a value. So based on that, PMI is there. Otherwise, it's very difficult for you at the shop floor when you have 316 and 200 castings of 304, and they are mixed because they look all same actually. So PMI is important. Other testing in the valve castings. First, corrosion testing, that is IGC and SSCC. This testing, I'll show you the detail actually. IGC can be as per ASTM A262, practice B and E. Practice B, they are using ferrite sulfide and sulfuric acid as a mixture that will create a corrosive environment, and specimen size is 5 to 20 mm square. It can be a square plate of this particular area. It will be kept for 120 hours and boiled in this solution. And level of corrosion is calculated by mass loss. Acceptance criteria is 60 miles per year. This is not given in standard actually, acceptance criteria, but Shell, they have mentioned that 60 miles per hour is acceptable for practice B. For practice E, there is separate way of doing it. Is copper sulfate and sulfuric acid mixture is there, and specimen size is 75 mm long minimum, boiled for 15 hours. A bend test is there with visual and microstructure to determine whether the structure is failed or not. Acceptance criteria, no cracks at 20 microns, and microstructure is checked at 250. Photographs are required. This is little more stringent compared to B. So E, when you have try to see that whether photos are required by the customer or whether they are asking for microstructure check for at 250. If they are asking for microstructure, see what standards we have to follow, whether it is as per supplementary standard of the ASME material or whether we have to go for, there's an handbook, ASME handbook also, which gives us more detail about microstructure. So try to see which is the standard which we have to follow. Mostly done on stainless steel material. Second, pitting and grease corrosion test as per ASME G48. Here there are method A and B. Qualification of alloy to pitting and crevice corrosion at specific temperature. Solution is 6% FeCl3, time is 24 hour minimum. And method E, critical pitting corrosion temperature of stainless steel nickel alloys, 24 hours solutions to be kept, and 6% Fe3Cl3 plus 1% HCl. Acceptable corrosion is 1 as per customer requirement or 4 as per shell specification, and it is mostly done on duplex and super duplex steel material. Next, sulfide stress cracking corrosion test as per NACE TM0177. Here there are 4 methods, A, B, C, D. A is NACE standard tensile test. Here what they will do, they will have an H2S saturated aqueous brine solution. Our time is to 720 and tensile test results should match before and after. No crack on gauge length. So here this sample will be under tension. There will be gas passing through this, that is H2S saturated gas, and there is a brine solution inside. So under this it should not crack, and both should match, the results before and after should match the values. Okay, next, microstructure test. Here details are given in the supplementary of the ASTM standard, where all the details are available. Level 4, there are different level, level 1, level 2 and up to 5 level. So based on the customer requirement, they will tell you which level is acceptable for microstructure. Impact test, again when the temperature is say minus 46 degree centigrade or minus 196 degree centigrade, or it is a PED order, then impact test is mandatory, and it is as per ASTM E23 or section 8. So you have to follow that and see what is the temperature required. Next is harness. ASTM E10 is the standard for that. And let us consider a scenario where you have a NACE material, which as per either, I mean, MR0175 or MR0103 upstream or downstream. And there the harness requirement is 22 HRC. So if that is the case, then you have to make sure that the hardness is not more than 22. Okay, can be a issue when you have to check with your heat treatment cycle also to make sure that it doesn't go above 22. So that is an area where you have to check if NACE and hardness is required by the customer. So that should be an indication to you that, you know, there could be a possibility that we might have to change a little bit our heat treatment cycle. So it will give you an indication in that sense. Thank you very much for your time, and I hope you like my video.